The Bible tells us that time is running out. The prophecies of Daniel and Revelation are being fulfilled today. Can there be peace in our world? Does God really have an answer? What secrets does history reveal? What does the future hold? Stay tuned. The book of Revelation speaks hope.
Now, tonight's study also is central. The final truth about hell. I want to share with you probably the most famous verse in all of Scripture. It's John 3:16. I wish you'd read it with me, please, from the screen. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. This wonderful statement, in a very concise and direct way, summarizes the final truth about hell. You'll notice that there are two options that Jesus mentions in this central passage to understanding the gospel. Do you see the two options? Whoever believes in Jesus will not what?
Perish.
That's simple. That's straight. But what's the other option? If we do not perish, then we will do what? We will have everlasting life. It is either perishing without Christ, or it is living forever with him. There's the two options. And God has invested everything in preventing the first option from ever taking place for any human being. He so loved the world that he gave Jesus that whoever believes in him should not perish. So the question then simply is this. If a person chooses not to believe in Jesus, what is going to happen to that person? It seems rather straightforward, doesn't it? And it is, friends. It's just as straightforward as that. And to put it in a more, shall I say, direct manner, here's the question we're really looking at this evening. Why would a loving God burn sinners in hell for millions of years anyway? Why would he do that? What would it accomplish? In fact, this question does not state it as strongly as some believe it, because millions is not long enough. Millions should be billions, and then maybe trillions, and then you can't put a number on it. But dear friends, is that really the picture that the Bible presents? I believe that that is an extreme. And oftentimes in studying Bible truth, we are to walk without going to the right hand or to the left hand. And here is a subject where we need balance. We need biblical balance. Now, the other option that some people go to, the other extreme, is to trivialize hell and make it into such an inconsequential and it's such a horrific idea that it couldn't possibly exist at all. That is equally dangerous. And God would not want us to fall into either ditch. Either one is dangerous. Therefore, what is the real truth about it? Well, we'll find that truth in the Word of God. In fact, in the very first part of the book of Revelation, Jesus says, "Do not be afraid. I am he who lives and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And I have the keys of Hades and of death." Hades was often an expression, another expression for hell. Jesus is the one who has the final word on this subject, as we will see. Scripture indicates that there is to be an ultimate end of hell itself. Thank God for that. Then death and Hades were cast into the lake of fire. The Bible says this is the second death, Revelation 20, 14. Death and Hades have had a long history of inflicting pain and fear on millions of people. But someday, dear friends, the good news is they're going to be gone and gone forever. But I want to tell you something. In getting rid of death and hell itself, it has cost God everything he has. Everything. Contemplate this passage with me for a moment, friends. The scripture says we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death. Oh, I know Jesus came into this world because he loved me. He became a man to show his love for the human family. But dear friends, Jesus came into this world because he was on a mission to bring down the kingdom of hell. And there was only one way to do it, and that was to die. The scripture says that he, by the grace of God, might taste death for everyone. Contemplate that. That in bringing down the citadel of death itself, Jesus took my death. He died the death that I deserved, that I could have the life that he deserves. He tasted death for me. For me. And the scripture passage goes on to say, he himself likewise shared in the same. And this is speaking of our humanity. He shared in the same that through death, he might destroy him who had the power of death, that is the devil. My dear friends, Jesus did not come into this world to just do a halfway work. When the plan of salvation is finished, there will be no more death. There will be no more author of death. It will be over, and over forever. He is going to destroy him who had the power of death. That is the devil. So what is this subject of hell? When is it going to happen? And where will it take place? And a critical question, how long will it last? You know, if you've ever had the opportunity to see somebody build a fence, if you see just one post out in a field somewhere, well, you might not be sure if there's going to be a fence there or not. But if you drive by a day or two later and you see three or four fence posts, one after the next, well, you're pretty sure that a fence is going up, right? And in some ways, it's that way in Bible study. If there's one passage that says one thing, and then you find another passage that lines up with that same passage, and then you find a third passage, and you find a fourth passage that lines up, you're seeing clearer and clearer what the Bible teaches. It's possible for one passage to be taken out of its setting or context, and it can possibly distort the picture of the truth. But truth, God has scattered seeds of truth and grains of truth on various subjects in different places in the scripture, and when we bring them together, we see a wonderful, marvelous picture of the truth. It's dangerous to take passages and twist them. This danger is pointed out in the writings of the Apostle Peter. He said, "Our beloved brother Paul has written to you, in which are some things hard to understand." which untaught and unstable people do what? They twist to their own destruction, as they do also the rest of the scriptures. 2 Peter 3:15 to 16. So we want to be careful on this subject, as well as all subjects, to take into consideration the context, to take into consideration as many passages as we can, to make sure that we are walking on solid ground. That's why we give you a variety of texts each and every evening. We're doing our best to avoid any kind of distortion of the Word of God. And I just want to encourage you to look up the scriptures, read your supplementary study guides, make sure that you are seeing what the Bible is actually saying. Now, when we consider this subject, we know that the scripture is our guide, our only dependable guide, because human opinion is one thing, but we need something from the Lord. Truth is from above. The Bible uses this expression 54 times in the King James Version. 31 times, hell is translated as the grave in the Old Testament. 31 times. In the New Testament, it comes out 23 times altogether. 6 times translated as the grave, 1 time as a place of darkness, and 16 times as a fiery destruction. 54 times altogether. Now, notice this next fact. Heaven is mentioned 550 times plus. Would you say amen, friends? Now, which subject is God trying his best to get across? I mean, a lot of folk, when they think of God, they think of, you know, the hot place. Instead of thinking about heaven, they're thinking about something else. It would be appropriate to say, in this setting, an enemy has done this. Because the enemy is trying his best to cloud the picture of God in the minds of people. He doesn't want people to see God for what he really is. Because when you do, you want to serve him. You want to love him. So I just put this in here to give us some perspective on the subject. But nevertheless, Jesus has some of the strongest things to say about this subject. Listen. "And fear not them which kill the body, but are not able to kill the soul, but rather fear him which is able to do what? Destroy both soul and body in hell." That's pretty direct. That's pretty straightforward. Why would Jesus say something like this? Because, dear friends, there is a reality that is facing the sinner. A reality that someday, if a person does not find a refuge in Jesus, there will be no shelter. There will be no hiding place. There is no other option. Jesus says, reverence God. Respect God. Because he's able to destroy both soul and body in hell. Now, the point that I'd like to make here is that Jesus speaks of a destruction, not of an ongoing, eternally burning, but rather a destruction of the person. Now, somebody might say, well, Steve, wait a minute. Doesn't Jesus talk about the rich man and Lazarus? Now, I'm bringing this up because sooner or later you will meet this question, and I want to do my best to help you see it the way I believe that Jesus is emphasizing it. Jesus did tell a story, a parable, about the rich man and Lazarus. And friends, it's quite a dramatic story. There was a man who had everything. He had all the food. He had wealth, tremendous wealth. We don't know his name, but there was a beggar man by the name of Lazarus. And he was covered with sores, and he didn't have anything. And the rich man thought he would do him a favor by allowing him to sit on his doorstep and kind of look in through the window, so to speak, and see all the good things that were going on inside. He was really generous, wasn't he? But then, as so often happens in Jesus' stories, he pulls a zinger on the audience. They said they both died, and the rich man ended up in hell. And the poor man ended up in Abraham's bosom. And of course, by now, everybody's listening, because in Jesus' time, if you were wealthy, it automatically meant that you were going to paradise. I mean, you obviously were going. You were under the blessing of God. Now, there are several reasons why I believe that Jesus is telling a story here, using a commonly understood appreciation or understanding of hell, commonly held in Jesus' day, but nevertheless, figurative language is being used. And I say that because of three things. First of all is Abraham's bosom. Nowhere in the Bible does it talk, except here, about the righteous going to Abraham's bosom at death. How big of a bosom would Abraham have to have? I mean, we're talking here about symbolic language. This is a figure of speech. Okay, that's a figure of speech, but what about that second part where the saved and the lost are talking back and forth? This is not a picture of the future reality as we understand it from other portions of Scripture. And finally, the rich man pled for help, and he said, if somebody could just come and put a drop of water on the tip of my tongue, I would be relieved. Now, dear friends, if that isn't symbolic, if that isn't figurative language, I don't know what is. A drop of water on the tip of your tongue will not alleviate your pain when you are burning. No, no. So then what was Jesus getting at in this story? I believe there are three lessons. First lesson, relationships. The importance of relationships. How we treat other people. Abraham speaks these words to the rich man in the parable. He said, remember that in your lifetime you received your good things, and likewise Lazarus, evil things. But now, he is comforted and you are tormented. Dear friends, the way we treat one another is decisive. This is extremely important. Relationships are decisive for your future. Second, decisions. Jesus said, speaking through Abraham in this story, and besides all this, he said, between us and you there is a great gulf fixed, so that those who want to pass from here to you cannot. My friends, the decisions we make in this life are fixed at death. There is no change. There is no shifting sides after that. And Jesus sought to emphasize that during this life we are making the decisions that will be fixed at eternity, at death. And the third lesson is the importance of the Word of God. Through Abraham, in this story, he says to the rich man, because the rich man pled with him, he said, if somebody would just go and tell my brothers about this terrible place, then they wouldn't come here either. They'd make the right choices. And Abraham says, no, If they do not hear Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded though one rise from the dead. Luke 16:31. The importance of listening to the Word of God cannot be overstressed. It is absolutely imperative. And as if to punctuate this very lesson, as the crowning act in Jesus' public ministry, he raised a man from the dead in broad daylight by the name of Lazarus. And the scripture records that the religious bigotry was so entrenched that not only did the religious leaders go about to destroy Jesus, but they went about to destroy Lazarus himself. This is the length to which the enemy will lead a person who shuts himself or herself off from the Word of God. So, when does hell really happen? If it doesn't happen immediately at death, when does it take place? I want you to open your Bibles so that we can read this passage right out of the scripture. But you can see that I've emphasized that it takes place at the end of the age. But let's read that from Jesus' own words in Matthew 13, beginning with the 38th verse. This is on page 948 of your seminar Bible. Jesus, again, is telling a story. He's using the natural world to illustrate Bible truth. He says, the field is the world. He's using an agricultural illustration here, a farm illustration. The field is the world. The good seeds are the sons of the kingdom, and the tares are the sons of the wicked one. The enemy who sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the what? The end of the age. And the reapers are the angels. Therefore, as the tares are gathered and burned in the fire, so it will be when? At the end of this age. The Son of Man will send out his angels, and they will gather out of his kingdom all things that offend, and those who practice what? Lawlessness. And will cast them into the furnace of fire. There will be wailing and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine forth as the sun in the kingdom of their Father. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. Dear friends, Jesus tells it like it will be. He does not pull any punches. We can hear what is going to happen in the future. I don't believe God is trying to scare us into heaven, but I do believe he is alerting us to the reality, the awesome and fearful reality of neglecting so great a salvation. Let's not do it. What do you say? Let's not neglect it. Let's hold on to Jesus. Let's let the seed, which is the Word of God, have root in our hearts and grow up in our lives. For there is an awesome reality at the end of the age. The Bible says, for the wicked are reserved for the day of doom. They shall be brought out on the day of wrath. Job 21:30. Now we know they're reserved in the grave. We studied that just a couple of evenings ago. That when a person dies, they don't immediately go to hell or to heaven. They rest in the grave, awaiting the resurrection. The Bible says, the Lord knoweth how to deliver the godly out of temptations and to reserve the unjust unto the day of judgment to be punished. 2 Peter 2:9. Is there a judgment for the wicked? There certainly is. Are there consequences to the actions that we take from day to day? There certainly are. It's an awesome reality. But the Bible makes plain that it will be a resurrection for the righteous and a resurrection for the unrighteous. Jesus said, all who are in the graves will hear his voice and come forth, those who have done good unto the resurrection of life, and those who have done evil to the resurrection of condemnation. We studied last evening how that the book of Revelation reveals, chapter 20 reveals, that 1,000 years separate those two resurrections. The first resurrection is for the righteous. Blessed and holy is he who has part in the first resurrection. On such the second death has no power. Thank God. But oh friends, those who rise in the resurrection of condemnation, they have no shelter. They have no shelter. Oh friends, this is the whole point of a study on hell, is to help men and women understand the realities and lead them to find shelter, to find hope, to find an anchor in Jesus Christ. The Bible says clearly, then death and Hades were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. It's called the second death because virtually everyone throughout history has fallen under the power of the first death. Jesus did not die to redeem us from the first death. I think that's plain. But it is this death that Jesus has died to redeem us, to secure us from ever having to experience this. But notice what it's called. It's called the second death. And as we have concluded in our study on the subject of death, there is a radical difference between being dead and being alive. Death is the absence of life. In fact, the scripture says the last enemy that will be destroyed is death. 1 Corinthians 15:26. Notice that death is not looked upon in friendly terms. Oh no, it's an enemy. It's an intruder. It's something to be feared and hated for what it really is. Something that breaks hearts, something that separates people from God. Oh friends, God hates it and hates what causes it. The wages of sin is death. And that enemy will be destroyed. But where does it happen? Where does it happen? Well, we saw last night from the book of Revelation, chapter 20, verse 9, that when the hosts of wicked arise in that second resurrection, they will be led under the spell of the enemy once again to fight God, to carry on just where they left off. And they went up on the breadth of the earth and surrounded the camp of the saints and the beloved city. And fire came down from God out of heaven and did what? Devoured them. Devoured them. This is not a picture of an ongoing, eternally burning hell. This is a picture of a consummation, of a catastrophic destruction of those who have chosen to live apart from Jesus Christ. The scriptures add that the elements will melt with fervent heat. Both the earth and the works that are in it will be what? Burned up. Peter says all these things will be dissolved. Dissolved. 2 Peter 3:10 to 13. The Bible says our God is a consuming fire. Sin in the presence of God is combustible. If we cling to it, dear friends, God will eradicate us with it. But as I have tried to emphasize over and over again, Jesus has gone to incredible lengths, unimaginable lengths, to redeem us, to secure us, to win our hearts, to lead us to safety. But the Bible says, "Behold, the righteous shall be recompensed in the earth, much more the wicked and the sinner." The Bible is clear. Hell takes place on this earth. That's right. That's taken from Proverbs 11:31. And when we think of this subject of hell, we need to look at it in the light of all of Scripture. And you remember that just immediately after this picture of the final destruction of the wicked in Revelation, the scene shifts. And John says, "Now I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away." Now I want you to open your Bibles to Revelation 21 and verse 4. And I want you to see the relationship of this awesome fact to the subject that we're studying tonight. Revelation 21 and verse 4. We've seen that there's going to be a new heaven and a new earth. God is going to recreate this world in the same glory and splendor that it was at the very beginning. The plan of salvation encompasses the total recovery of this world. What a glorious day that will be. And people are going to live in this world. That's right. But I want you to see something wonderful here, a tremendous assurance from God's Word. Revelation 21:4. "And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying. There shall be no more pain, for the former things have passed away." Oh, I praise God for that revelation. Because what that tells me, friends, is simply this. If there was a place somewhere on this world or anywhere in the universe where people that I had known were still being burned alive, that verse could never be true. Could never be true. I would not be able to enjoy heaven. Nobody would. God Himself would not be able to enjoy it. If people were being tormented alive, I mean, not even a monster could endure that for ages and ages and ages. Is that the picture of God in His Word? Oh, no. What we're seeing in this passage is post-destruction of the wicked. After the wicked have been destroyed, God is going to wipe away all tears from our eyes. It is at that time that there will be no more death. At that time, there will be no more sorrow, no more crying, and no more pain. Nail it down, friends. Nail it down. God is not going to have an ongoing, festering, cancerous, sore, like an eternally burning hell. It's going to be gone. It's going to be gone. "His name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." Of the increase of His government and peace, there will be no end. Isaiah 9, 6 and 7. No end to the increase of peace throughout all eternity. I say, friends, when you bring together all of the Scriptures and you see the character of Jesus, the character of God, It's incompatible with an eternally burning, unending, tormenting hell. So then how long does it last? Please open your Bibles to Malachi chapter 4. One of the last verses in the Old Testament helps us to see clearly the teaching of Scripture. Malachi chapter 4, beginning with the first verse, page 931. For behold, the day is coming, burning like an oven, and all the proud, yes, all who do wickedly will be stubble. And the day which is coming shall do what? Burn them up, says the Lord of hosts, that will leave them neither root nor branch. But to you who fear my name, the Son of Righteousness shall arise with healing in his wings, and you shall go out and grow fat like stall-fed calves. You shall trample the wicked, for they shall be what? They shall be ashes under the soles of your feet on the day that I do this, says the Lord of hosts. Well, this simply emphasizes what the Bible teaches consistently, that there is a reality called hell. There is a reality of destruction that is awaiting all of the proud and all that choose to live apart from the wonderful love and will of God. God is not going to allow this cancer of sin to simply go on and on and on. He's going to bring it to an end. But when it does come to an end, it will come to an end. Thank God. And the wicked will be reduced to stubble. It will burn them up. They will be ashes under the soles of your feet, the Bible says. For yet a little while, and the wicked shall be what? No more. Indeed, you will look carefully for his place, but it shall be no more. But the meek shall inherit the earth and shall delight themselves in the abundance of peace. Psalm 37, 9 to 11. So somebody says, Steve, now wait a minute. This all sounds very consistent and very wonderful, but doesn't the Bible speak about forever and ever? And I'm sharing with you the very scriptures that sooner or later you will come across that have caused some people to conclude that yes, there is an unending torment that will go on, as the Bible says here, forever and ever. Or does it? And the smoke of their torment ascends forever and ever, and they have no rest day or night who worship the beast and his image. Revelation 14, 11. Yeah, it looks pretty straightforward, doesn't it? Here's another one. In Revelation 20, verse 10, it says, the devil who deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, and they will be tormented day and night forever and ever. Very strong language. Dear friends, we conclude from this passage and the previous passage that for some in the fires of hell, it will not be over in a second. Individuals that have caused much pain to hundreds, thousands, yes, indeed, millions of people are not going to be consumed in a moment. If we have caused pain to somebody else, that pain is going to come back in equal measure. And there is only one way to avoid that law of sowing and reaping. And that's at the foot of the cross. That's the only way, dear friends. Otherwise, it will come back in an avalanche upon us. And for some, it will not be over in a second. But what does it mean? Forever and ever. Does the Bible ever use the expression forever to mean something less than an unending period of time? Sure enough, it certainly does. Jonah, when he was thrown into the sea from the ship, he writes about it and says, I went down to the moorings of the mountains, the earth with its bars closed behind me forever. Well, that's interesting because we know that Jonah was only down there for how long? 3 days and three nights. That may have seemed like forever to Jonah. But here is a clear example of where forever is limited by the circumstances. We also see it in the life of Samuel. His mother dedicated him at birth. She said, I will take him that he may appear before the Lord and remain there forever. Well, what does forever mean in this setting? It's explained a few verses farther on. Therefore, she said, I also have lent him to the Lord as long as he lives. He shall be lent to the Lord. So forever has to be seen in its context. And yes, it is clear that forever is going to be a period of time for the wicked in hell. But many other passages make plain that that time is going to have an end. The wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. But somebody says, Steve, now wait a minute. Jesus talked about everlasting punishment. What about that? As Jesus approached the final hours of his life, he gathered several of his disciples and he shared with them the future events to our world's history. And he shared with them the condition of people in the last days. And he shared with them that in the final day, there are going to be but two classes. And the characteristics of those two classes are shared in considerable detail. Jesus said, then the king will say to those on his right hand, come, you blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. Thirsty, a stranger, naked, sick, in prison, and you came to me. You did it to me. Those are the ones that are on his right hand. Then he will say also to those on the left hand, depart from me, you cursed, into the everlasting fire prepared for the devil and his angels. I don't know of any more fearful words in all the Bible than those three words, depart from me. For all through history, God has been inviting, come, 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 come. And now, at the end, Jesus says, depart. Depart. For I was hungry and you gave me no food, no drink. You did not take me in. You did not clothe me. You did not visit me. You did not do it to me. Do you see how important it is, our relationships with one another and with people in need? This is a critical issue, dear friends. I don't believe it can be overstressed. Jesus goes on to say, and these will go away into everlasting punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. Matthew 25, 31 to 46. Now listen carefully, friends, because there is a tremendous difference between everlasting punishment and everlasting punishing. Which did Jesus say? Everlasting punishment. A punishment is something that happens at a point in time. Punishing is something that is ongoing. It may seem like a slight difference, but it has tremendous consequences. And lest we misunderstand this, we have illustrations from actual history to help us. This is a punishment with everlasting consequences. That's the significant point here. The consequences are eternal. But the punishment, whether it is short or long in the fires of hell, will come to an end. Thank God for that. But the results will go on throughout eternity. The results. There is no resurrection from the second death. There is no hope. Now is the accepted time. Today is the day of salvation. Now the doors are open. Now Jesus is saying, come. Come. This matter of everlasting fire or eternal fire, because they're the same expression in the Greek language, very same expression. This matter of everlasting fire is nailed down by actual events. Look at Jude chapter 1. Well, there's only one chapter in Jude, but we can say Jude 1, 7, or we can say Jude 7. You'll find the place either way. This is on page number 1173. The Lord, in His mercy, has given us actual historical events to help us understand what He is talking about versus in the subject of consequences versus an ongoing, eternally burning hell. Jude 7 makes plain this fact. It says, as Sodom and Gomorrah, and the cities around them, in a similar manner to these, having given themselves over to sexual immorality and gone after strange flesh, are set forth as an example, suffering the vengeance of eternal fire. Sodom and Gomorrah, you remember the story, had fallen under tremendous sin. And God sent angels into that city to bring out every righteous person they could find, and there was just a handful. There weren't even 10 people. If God could have found 10 people, He would have spared the whole city. Couldn't. But the Bible makes plain that they're suffering the vengeance of eternal fire. Well, what is that vengeance? Well, today, archaeologists, the best they understand about where the location of Sodom and Gomorrah was is that it's underneath, in all likelihood, it's underneath the Dead Sea. Now, it's an interesting fact that the Dead Sea is the lowest spot on the face of the earth, over 1,300 feet below sea level is the Dead Sea. And to the best of our understanding, what's left of Sodom and Gomorrah is underneath that spot. Now the question is, are they still burning? Well, of course not. They're not burning now, but I assure you, the consequences of that eternal fire are with us to this day. They were totally destroyed, and the destruction has never been undone. And as if to put the clincher on this, Peter echoes this. He says that the Lord turned the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah into what? Into ashes. Condemned them to destruction, making them an example to those who afterward would live ungodly. It's crystal clear, friends. There is a destruction of the wicked. If we choose to cling to the ways of this world, if we hold on to sin, eventually there will be a day of reckoning. And the destruction will be complete. And its effects will be eternal. I assure you that for the God who has made men and women in his image and who has redeemed us by the blood of the Lamb, this is an agonizing step to take. You may recall that when mad cow disease broke out in Europe, in Great Britain, that the farmers of that country were compelled to destroy thousands of cattle. The other option would have been to infect the entire nation. Every cow would have had to be destroyed without this drastic step. And in some respects, God is taking the same step. Sin is so highly toxic, so highly contaminating, that unless it is stopped, will spread. And so cows were destroyed. They had to be burned to stop the spread of that highly contagious disease. And so the scripture says anyone not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. Revelation 20, verse 15. This, the Bible says, is the second death. But notice that the Bible reveals what's going on inside the heart of God. He says, as I live, saith the Lord God, I have what? No pleasure in the death of the wicked. There's the truth of what we're studying this evening right there. The death of the wicked. God has no pleasure in it, but that the wicked do what? Turn from his way and what? And live. He says, turn from your evil ways, for why should you die? Oh, friends, I don't believe we'll ever fully comprehend the pain that sin has brought to the heart of God. Calvary reveals something of it. But what God has experienced, what he is going through every day with this world and its agony. And nevertheless, the Bible reveals that the Lord will rise up, that he may do his work, his awesome work, and bring to pass his act, his unusual act. Old King James put it right here, his strange act. A destruction determined upon, even upon the whole world. Isaiah 28, 21, and 22. Yes, the Creator, the life giver, finds no joy in destroying the wicked. This is foreign to him, but nevertheless, he will do it. He will do it. The Bible says, he will do it. But we serve a God of tender mercy, Luke 1:78. We see his mercy in all of his creatures. The Bible says that his compassions are like the waves of the sea. They're fresh every day. Every day, they're new. They fail not. What a marvelous God we have. He cares for us. Some years ago, a farmer out in Australia was away from home for just a short period of time, but one of those brush fires came up and destroyed his home, including a chicken coop that had chickens in it. And as he came home, he found nothing but a pile of rubble. And as he looked through the burned piles of rubble and what was left of the chicken coop, he noticed burned piles of feathers. He kicked one of those piles of feathers, and here's what he saw. He saw little baby chickens come out from under a mother hen that had shielded them with her own body. Oh, I think that's a wonderful, wonderful thing, dear friends. Because God has put into even to animals' minds this desire to shelter in a time of need, even at the expense of its own life. That came from God. That came from God. And the scripture says, "He shall cover you with his feathers, and under his wings you shall take refuge. His truth shall be your shield." Psalm 91:4. Oh, friends, the overwhelming fires of affliction and destruction and hell, our Savior has taken that for us. We can safely commit the keeping of our life to Him. He will see us through to the very end. Would you like to send Jesus the word this evening that you want to thank Him for His great salvation? If that's your desire, would you just join me in standing? Praise God. Lord, we do thank You. We thank You so much. What words are too feeble to express our gratitude for the gift of the life of Your only Son. His life for our life. Lord, what can we say but we praise Your name. We want to live for You. We want You to live in our hearts. We want Your truth to be our shield. Father, this evening we have studied very serious material. I pray that You will deepen the impression that Your word has made upon our minds this evening. Help us to hold on to the picture that we have seen tonight, that You are a loving God, that Your justice is not incompatible with Your mercy, that Your justice is an equal revelation of Your love, that You hate sin so much that You will destroy it. Oh Lord, I know that You agonize over every single soul. I pray that You will give us a similar concern for the people that we know who don't know You yet. And Father, if there's anything in our hearts that would lead us away from You, I pray that You will help us, that You will save us from ourselves, that You will protect us, that You will put a shield around us, a wall of fire that will keep us from the enemy's darkness. Lord, I pray now that You'll be with us as we go to our homes, that You will protect the words that have been sown in our minds, and that You will bring us back to continue our study of Your word tomorrow evening. Be with us now, we pray, in Your precious name. Amen.